resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live, and whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though this body be destroyed, yet shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not as a stranger. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
Make me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters.
He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
Yea, so I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me.
Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help?
My help cometh even from the Lord, who hath made heaven and earth.
He will not suffer thy foot to be moved, and he that keepeth thee will not sleep.
Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep.
The Lord himself is thy keeper, the Lord is thy defense upon thy right hand.
So that the sun shall not burn them by day, neither the moon by night.
The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. Yea, it is even he that shall keep thy soul.
The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth forevermore.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The epistle is written in the 8th chapter of Romans. St. Paul's epistle to the Romans, beginning at the 14th verse. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. all souls in life. Vouchsafe, we beseech thee, to thy whole church in paradise and on earth, thy light and thy peace. And grant that we, following the good examples of those who have served thee here and are now at rest, may at the last enter with them into thine unending joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The epistle is written in the fourth chapter of 1 Thessalonians, beginning at the 13th verse. I would not have you be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven, and with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain alive shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Here endeth the epistle.
Thanks be to God.
Again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that every one which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him up at the last day.
Praise be to the Lord Christ.
My time to preach. It's a good thing we have our church secretary Judy, and I know Bella knows her. Of course, she comes in and talks to Judy, and it's on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and she keeps me on track in that office. But one of the beautiful things that's offered through her work is putting together this program, which I hope you'll take home, and if you want more copies, we can make them for you. And some beautiful pictures of Phil and Ellen, and so thank you, Judy, for doing that. And so also, it's a guide for me to stay on track as well here at this Requiem. So now I'm going to go ahead and preach. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Amen. I'm so grateful that I have gotten to know Phil over the years, and Ellen, I don't really know how many years it's been, but it seems like a good stint. And one of the remarkable things, one of the things I loved, was to go to the home of Phil and Ellen. And Ellen would be working, slaving away in the middle school there, dealing with middle schoolers. And if you don't think that's across the bay, it is. God bless. I remember my middle school age years.
I was just happy they were over after the eighth grade and went to high school. But what I enjoyed sitting with Phil, he was a wonderful conversationalist. I mean, that guy, and what I loved about him, it kind of mirrored one of our own people here, one of our dear souls, Father Gates Greer. He had a way of choosing just the right word, and he'd be very selective in the words he chose to give you an accurate description of what he was trying to convey. It was a beautiful thing to behold, because he took such care and just an astuteness of the beauty of life and all that we encounter in this life, those beautiful things. And as an engineer with aerospace companies and also being involved in the satellites and all this configuration, I'm not a scientist, so I can't do that verbiage that he could. But what I appreciated about him was he loved life. And of course, if you're a scientist, engineer, looking up in the heavens, which he did, you can't help but marvel at the beauty of God's creation. So I really just relished those talks, the stories of growing up, and it was just, he was fun to sit and be with. He was a true joy. And then the time would pass by, it'd be a couple hours later, I gotta go, you know, and then, well, I gotta go too. And so, but it was a lot of fun. I'm so grateful I had those times with him, Ellen. And, I know each of you certainly have cherished your time with him. As either you, I don't know, Christine is in Canada, wasn't able to attend, but as her, the sister of Phil. There's so much one can say about the life of this beautiful soul, which God created, and there is no one else like him. And he had talents and gifts which no one else had, and these are meant to glorify God. For this is why we are here, and. You know, we are grateful that this church is now able to go into, for instance, a public school, just one block over. And I think you know this, in the last 3 weeks, we have been teaching, above all things, the Bible to public school students. Isn't that a miracle? It's an after-school program, which was started a few weeks ago. And already in the third week, and the children are just eating it up. They love the games, and even I get up and stand up and dance around with these hokey songs and sing memory verses. And thankfully, no one's recording that. Anyway, you know, and one of the things they, as far as the teaching aids for this Bible club, is this little wordless book. And it essentially explains God's gift of the story of our salvation through his son, Jesus Christ. It has no words in it, but it has, as you notice, colors in it. And so we look at that first color. I think we just finished red, and now we're on. Gold was the first color. So when you think of gold, you think of heaven, you know? And we have St. John's description in the book of Revelation of the stones or the walkways, the sidewalks, are covered in gold, or gold. And so you think of gold, you think of cheerful things, of precious things, of joyous things. And obviously, you know, it's interesting that if you want to think of heaven, we think of these things, and there is harmony there, like there is in the universe. There's that harmony and beautiful order of all things. If you look at, say, a butterfly's wings here in the desert, about this time of year, they start coming out at Red Rock Canyon. And I remember one year, we were up at that visitor center there at Red Rock, and you could look under a microscope at one of those butterfly's wings. It was iridescent. It was beautiful. These little details that God shows to glorify, all things glorify him to show their love for him. And so when we think about it in heaven, it's a little here on earth, it can be a little difficult because we see what's going on out there. But I think one of the closest things I've ever had to experiencing heaven was in church camp as a teenager. Now, maybe the first day and second day, we hated to be there. We wanted to get out of there. It's like, I don't want to have anything to do with these people. And so, but after about the third day, then we started to get into the rhythm. And we began to get along with each other. We began to live out what we were hearing in the gospel lessons and also of what we were experiencing, of love being conveyed to one to another, and knowing that Jesus was present and working in and through us, we began to experience a little bit of heaven. And then we were sad to have to go on to our ways after church camp. But you see, what happens is that we deal with sin in our lives, and since the dawn of time, since the dawn of human consciousness, man's proclivity is to turn inward on the self. In other words, to say, this is mine, it's not yours. And see what happens when you, if you're on the, do you ever remember in elementary school when you were on the playing field, maybe throwing, passing the ball around the kids, and then one kid decides, no, I'm not going to pass it around, it's mine, I'm taking it, I'm out of here. I mean, doesn't that just destroy all the fun? And that's what we do. I mean, God has shown us a way. If he, anything, he is a God of order, and especially there is a moral order, which essentially means it's the discipline of love. So when we pass that ball to the other kids, what does that mean? We're giving of ourselves. We're sharing what we have. And when we get into that rhythm of, this is what all of creation does, is to glorify God, to give of oneself. If you lose yourself, you find yourself, Jesus said. Give it all away. Show your love. It's sacrificial love, agape love, which Jesus did on the cross for his bride, the church, and for all of humanity. He showed his love for us. No greater love, St. John chapter 15, verse 13, hath a man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. And certainly if you served in the military, you understand that. That you're willing to give your life for your fellow soldiers because you have that love for them that is beyond expression. And so Jesus did that for us that we might have eternal life in him and do away with this blackness, which on our own we cannot achieve heaven because you and I can never achieve and say, have you loved God enough? And I think if we're honest with ourselves, I know for me, it's only lately that I can say I'm beginning to understand what that means. And certainly Phil, he was beginning to experience it in a profound and beautiful way as he began to face his own mortality, but realizing in his faith in Christ Jesus that there was life beyond the grave. And so we see this red color, it's the next color, which we taught last yesterday at the school. And that red color symbolizes life. In the Jewish days during Jesus' time, the blood of the sacrificial lambs represented the blood as the life force of the animal, of the creature. So when Jesus sheds his blood and came forth from his side, a new creation was started, a new Eve, a new bride, and that's you and I, that's us, and that we are washed in the immaculate blood of Jesus Christ, and we are made clean and righteous before him. And so now we can approach him in this communion with him in Jesus Christ with God the Father. You see, heaven and earth now come together. The Mass, if you will, is the eternal transfixed in time. That is why the pulpit and lectern are not the central focus of our worship, but the altar, which symbolizes sacrifice. Because it is not what he said that saved us, but what he did. And so now we're in that learning, sanctification of growing in the knowledge and love of God. And in and through him, we can be that which we were made to be, and that is to give of ourselves sacrificially one to another and to him. I think I feel this, if I get too self-centered or too caught up in myself or my worries or my problems, it's when I go to visit somebody in the hospital. It's when I'm getting out of myself and thinking of others that I begin to experience this lightness and this joy which God wants us to experience at all times. And so now Phil is in paradise with our Lord Jesus. Of the 300 prophecies of Jesus, which said he was the Messiah and Savior of the world, those had been fulfilled, most of them. And that's remarkable for any individual, nothing else like it. So the gospel speaks of him as the Lord, the Son of God, and Savior of the world. And when he comes again the second time, he will fulfill the remaining prophecies. But what does all this mean? It means that you and I and our salvation really is rooted in this divine courtship, the divine courtship of love. And he calls each of us to join in that courtship that we might come to know him personally and fully. And heaven doesn't begin right before we die or after we die. Heaven can begin right here and right now. That risen life is available to each one of us if we open up the Bible, if we come to church, if we pray, and if we get into that stream communion and fellowship of being in his presence and listen to his guiding voice,
then we have harmony. We have that peace. We have that joy, which now Phil is experiencing in paradise with our Lord and with his loved ones in Christ. And so that is the gospel message I know he would want you to hear. That's why we're here. And so at the end of time in heaven, every tear shall be wiped away. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
As we behold him in these very humble means of bread and wine, which which are now his body and blood. As we behold him in this life, Phil is beholding him face to face. And so it is a way to draw close to our loved ones. And this is the closest we can get to him through Christ Jesus. It is a beautiful thing and a great comfort knowing that now he is with our Lord and that all suffering and pain have been removed. And that is our hope too, that we can experience the joys of heaven with him. So this holy sacrifice is offered to the greater glory of God for that wonderful gift he has given us. And that is his Son, Christ Jesus. Let us pray now, beginning with the words of the general confession. And so, can you say that invitation right there?
Yes, thank you. You do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways. Draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God devoutly kneeling.
Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may every hour serve and please thee in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all of your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up our hearts unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, in whom the hope of a blessed resurrection has shone upon us, that we who are saddened by the certainty of dying may be comforted by the promise of immortal life to come. For the life of thy faithful people, O Lord, is not taken away but changed. And though the tabernacle of their earthly habitation is dissolved, thou preparest them a house eternal in the heavens. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying,
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord Most High. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, who suffered death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself to one offer a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and in institute and in his holy gospel commanded to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying,
saying, drink ye all of this. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me.
Right.
this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but of thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table. But thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, we in all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins, be made clean by his body, and our souls washed with his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him that taketh away the sins of the world.
Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
thank thee for the knowledge of our Savior Jesus, who have newly received the holy mysteries, the spiritual food, the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. And just assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are buried in this incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people. And are also heirs to hope of thy everlasting kingdom by the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue that holy fellowship and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end.
Amen.
All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. He that raised up Jesus from the dead will also quicken our mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in us. Wherefore my heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh also shall rest in hope, and thou shalt show me the path of life. In thy presence is the fullness of joy. And at thy right hand there is pleasure forevermore. Unto Almighty God, we commend the soul of our brother departed, Phil. We commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection unto eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose coming in glorious majesty to judge the world, the earth and the sea shall give up their dead. And the corruptible bodies of those who sleep in him shall be changed and made like unto his glorious body, according to the mighty working whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, Write from henceforth, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so saith the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O merciful God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, in whom whosoever believeth shall live, though he die. And whosoever liveth and believeth in him shall not die eternally. Who also hath taught us by his holy apostle, St. Paul, not to be sorry as men without hope for those who sleep in him. We humbly beseech thee, O Father, to raise us from the death of sin unto the life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life, we may rest in him, and that at the general resurrection in the last day, we may be found acceptable in thy sight, and receive that blessing which thy well-beloved Son shall then pronounce to all who love and fear thee, saying, Come, ye blessed children of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of the world. Grant this, we beseech thee, O merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our Mediator and Redeemer.
Amen.
Thy hands, O merciful Savior, we commend the soul of Phil, thy servant, now departed from the body. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech thee, a sheep of thine own fold, a lamb of thine own flock, a sinner of thine own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of thy mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light, who livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Ghost, world without end.
Amen.
God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever.